Good morning, students. In our last class, we have studied about the formation of ionic bond and factors influencing the formation of ionic bond. Right? Now, let us discuss the next type of bonding, that is covalent bond. This is the bond formed by mutual sharing of an electron pair. Mutual sharing of an electron pair, which is formed, means that electron pair is formed, which is formed by equal contribution of both the bonded atoms. Equal contribution of both the bonded atoms, right? The bond formed by mutual sharing of an electron pair, which is formed by equal contribution of both the bonded atoms, is called as covalent bond. For example, you take H2 molecule. You take H2 molecule, hydrogen molecule. Now, hydrogen configuration, whose atomic number is 1, its configuration is 1s1. Actually, better to avoid the semicolon for time being, right? Because we have to use the Lewis dot model. If you take semicolon, we may feel it as a lone pair, that's why. Hydrogen's electronic configuration is 1s1. It has one electron in its outer shell. And to get the nearest inert gas configuration, what is nearest inert gas of hydrogen? Helium. To get helium configuration, hydrogen needs one more electron. So, let us take two such hydrogen atoms. This is one hydrogen whose electron is in this way. Another hydrogen atom is electron in this way. Now, what happens? These two electrons will form an electron pair. These two electrons will form an electron pair which is equally shared between the two atoms. Which is equally shared between the two atoms. See, now this electron pair belongs to first hydrogen as well as second hydrogen. So, the bond formed in this manner by sharing an electron pair which is formed by equal contribution of both the bonded atoms is said to be a covalent bond. The bond formed by these, now these two atoms are bonded. They are closer than earlier. See, now the bond formed by sharing an electron pair, which is formed by equal contribution of both the bonded atoms, is said to be covalent bond. Right? Let us take another example. Chlorine molecule. Chlorine atomic number is 17. Chlorine atomic number is 17, whose outer shell configuration is 3s2 3p5. 3s2 3p5 1 2 3 4 5. This is according to which rule? Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity from atomic structure. Pairing starts only when all the degenerate orbitals are singly filled. Right? Now chlorine has in the outer shell 3s2, 3px2, 3py2 and 3pz1. So chlorine has 7 electrons in its outer shell and need one more electron to get octet. Yes or no? The same way, another chlorine also has a similar electronic picture. One is 3s2, 3px2, 3py2, 3pz1. Now, when these two are approaching one another for bond formation, so they contribute one electron each. They contribute one electron each. See, this chlorine contributed its electron. Another chlorine also contributed its electron. And thus, formed an electron pair which is equally shared between the two atoms. So, here these two chlorines are bonded by sharing an electron pair which is formed by equal contribution of both the bonded atoms. Such a bond is called as covalent bond. For example, if you take this is example 1 hydrogen, example 2 chlorine molecule. Now, example 3, if you take oxygen molecule. Oxygen, 8 atomic number, whose electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p4. 2s2, 2p4. So, 2s2, it has a pair of electrons. 2p4 means 1, 2, 3 and 4. Totally, in the valency shell, oxygen has how many electrons? 6 electrons. So, to get octet set of configuration, oxygen needs how many more electrons? 2 more electrons. So, that's why each oxygen will try to get 2 more electrons by means of bond formation. So, let's get the electronic picture of oxygen. 2s2, 2px2, 2py1 and 2pz1. right? 2PY1 and 2PZ1. Similarly, another oxygen's electron picture also 2s2, 2px2, 2py1 and 2pz1. Thus, these two oxygens approach one another for the bond formation and thus form one electron pair in this way, another electron pair in this way. These two pairs are under mutual sharing, means these two oxygens see, this pair and this pair are mutually under sharing between the two oxygen atoms. Now, first oxygen has got 2 plus 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 electrons. Even second oxygen also has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, thus, a double bond is formed between the two oxygen atoms. In this way, using Lewis electron dot model, we can explain the formation of a covalent bond. Similarly, if you take example 4 as H2O molecule. Now, H2O, usually in any given molecule, less electronegative atom will be the central atom. In any given molecule, less electronegative atom, obviously less electronegative means larger atom. Larger atom will be the central atom. In H2O molecule, hydrogen is smaller in size. We know that oxygen is larger in size. So, oxygen electronic picture already we studied 2s2, 2px2, 2py1 and 2pz1. And with this oxygen, hydrogens are approaching for bond formation. See, each hydrogen has one unpaired electron, 1s1 and 1s1. Now, what happens between these two atoms and these two atoms? Sharing of electron pair formed by equal contribution will be taking place. Oxygen 2s2, 2px2. Oxygen and hydrogen will be sharing this electron pair. This oxygen and hydrogen will be sharing this electron pair. Thus, two covalent bonds are formed between oxygen and first hydrogen and oxygen and second hydrogen. Thus, using Lewis electron dot symbols, one can explain the bond formation, especially covalent bond formation in molecules. See, let us go through the rules for writing Lewis dot structures. Total number of electrons required for writing the structures. Total number of electrons required for writing Lewis dot structures can be obtained by adding all valency electrons of combining atoms. For example, methane molecule is there. One carbon and four hydrogens are getting combined. Carbon atomic number is 6, but valency electrons are 4 only. See, there will be a confusion among students initially. Atomic number is 6, but valence electrons are 4. So, one carbon contribute 4 valence electrons. Each hydrogen contribute 1 valence electrons. Totally 4 hydrogens contribute 4 valency electrons. So, 4 valency electrons from carbon, totally 4 valency electrons from 4 hydrogens, total 8 valency electrons are available for bonding. So, this is how the number of electrons required for bonding can be obtained from valency shells of all combining atoms. In case of anions, suppose some anion you take, XB or XY power minus 1 is there. Valence electrons of X must be counted, valence electrons of Y must be counted. In addition, so many negative charges means that many electrons must be added. In case of anions, each negative charge means addition of one electron. In case of anions, each negative charge means addition of one electron. Suppose it has two negative charges, addition of two electrons. Three negative charges, addition of three electrons, like that. And in case of cations, each positive charge means subtraction or removal of one electron from total electrons. Suppose if you take CH4-, consider CH4- anion. Carbon is contributing 4 valency electrons. Each hydrogen is contributing 1, totally 4 valency electrons. Out of 8 valency electrons, other than 8 valency electrons, 1 minus charge is there. 8 plus 1, total electrons available for writing the structure is 9 electrons. Similarly, one more example, CH3 minus, one H plus must be removed. Wait a moment, consider an anion CH3 minus. CH3 minus means carbon is contributing 4 electrons, each hydrogen is contributing one electron, totally 3 electrons. Other than these 7 valence electrons available from these combining atoms, one additional electron must be considered. So totally, how many electrons are available for us for writing Lewis dot model? 7 plus 1, 8 electrons are available. Similarly, you consider CH3 plus. CH3 plus means each carbon is contributing 4 electrons, each hydrogen is contributing 1, totally 3 electrons. 7 electrons are available from the valency shells of these atoms, and 1 plus charge means 1 electron must be subtracted. So out of 7 minus 1 means 6 electrons only available for writing the Lewis dot structure of CH3 plus. Like this, in case of anions, each negative charge you assign 1 extra electron. In case of cations, for every positive charge you subtract 1 electron. Next, here we can discuss one example. Carbonate CO3 power minus 2. Carbon is contributing 4 electrons. Each oxygen is contributing how many? Oxygen atomic number is 8. Oxygen's atomic number is 8, but valence electrons are 6. Each oxygen valence electrons are 6. 3 oxygen, 6 into 3, 18. And 2 minus charges are there, plus 2 electrons. So 4 from carbon, 6, 3 is 18 from oxygen, 22 plus 2, 24 electrons are available to write the Lewis dot structure of carbonate. Similarly, if you consider ammonium cation, nitrogen is contributing 5 valence electrons, each hydrogen is contributing 1 electron, totally 4 hydrogens contribute 4, 5 plus 4, 9, and 1 plus charge means we have to subtract 1 electron. Out of 9 minus 1, 8 valence electrons are available for writing Lewis dot structure. Okay, now after getting the total number of electrons available from all valency shells, distribute the total electrons as bonding electron pairs between the atoms. Bonding electron pairs between the atoms, such that total bonds must be equal. It's a guess actually, because of this reason only this Lewis dot structure was failed actually. So, see, distribute the total electrons as bonding shared electron pairs. Bonding shared electron pairs between atoms, between the bonding atoms, in proportion to the total number of bonds. Where is the data about the total number of bonds? That's the guess. We have to predict. Okay. Of course, some molecules one can predict, but all prediction is not possible. This is the area that is responsible for the failure of this Lewis dot model. And after arranging the number of electron pairs in proportion to the bonds required, rest of the electrons, see, suppose we have got here 24 electrons. Out of 24, suppose 8 electrons were arranged for bonds. A number I am giving you, 8 electrons were arranged for bonds. 24 minus 8, how many? 16 are left. Those 16 electrons must be given. See, the rest of the electrons are utilized either for multiple bonding. Still, if any more bonds are required for that multiple bond means either a double bond or a triple bond. Between two atoms, maximum 3 bonds are possible. If it is one electron pair sharing, single bond. Two electron pairs in sharing, double bond. Three electron pairs in sharing, triple bond, in that way. The rest of the electrons can be utilized for multiple bond if required, means if the number of bonds are not satisfied, or as a lone pair. To do all these steps, to follow all these steps, what's the basic requirement? That all atoms should get octet set of configuration. In order to give octet set of configuration for all atoms, we have to follow these rules, right? Now, let us go through some examples for writing Lewis dot structure. For example, HCl. Hydrogen can contribute 1 electron. Carbon can contribute 4 valence electrons totally. Chlorine can contribute 7 valence electrons totally. 8 valence electrons. Now, using these 8 valence electrons, we have to give the structure. So, between hydrogen and chlorine, 1, 2, hydrogen's helium set of configuration is acquired. So, hydrogen's part is fulfilled. Chlorine has to get 8 electrons in its outer shell. So, out of 8 electrons, we use it 2. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, totally chlorine has got its 8 electrons. Hydrogen has got it helium set of 1s2, 2 electron configuration finished. Now, when it comes to the next example, suppose methane, carbon can contribute 4 electrons, hydrogen each one can contribute 1 electron, 4 hydrogens can contribute 4 electrons. Totally, we are available with 8 electrons. Now, let us see carbon surrounded by 4 hydrogen atoms. Carbon surrounded by 4 hydrogen atoms. So, totally 8 electrons must be arranged in accordance with the number of bonds so that all atoms should get octet. That's the point to be noticed here. All atoms should get octet. And hydrogen, such atoms, hydrogen should get duplet set. So, 1, 2, hydrogen has got it duplet. 1, 2, hydrogen has got it duplet, duplet and duplet. Carbon also has got totally 8 electrons. See, carbon's octet is satisfied. Each hydrogen's duplet is also satisfied. Suppose if it is CH3 minus anion, carbon contributes 4 electrons as usual. Hydrogen 1 into 3, that is 3 electrons, and plus 1 additional electron, 8 electrons must be utilized here. So, carbon surrounded by 1, 2 and 3. So, totally 8 electrons must be arranged here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, each hydrogen's duplet set of configuration is finished. So, carbon's octet is not satisfied. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 only. Out of 8, 2 are left. And assign a minus charge. So, CH3 minus charge. Carbon is bearing a lone pair. Okay, and one more is CH3 plus. Again, as usual, carbon 4 and 3 hydrogens contribute 3. And plus 1 means minus 1 electron. Out of 7 electron, totally we are available with 6 valency electrons. Now, using those 6 valency electrons, carbon and hydrogens, 3 hydrogens must be bonded, right? So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Finished. 6 valence electrons are finished. One positive charge. Understood? Similarly, ammonium ion NH4 plus nitrogen can contribute 5 electrons, 4 hydrogens can contribute 4, 9 out of 9, 1 electron must be removed. That is 8 valence electrons are available to give the structure, Lewis dot structure of ammonium ion. So, nitrogen surrounded by 4 hydrogens. Already we have discussed in any given molecule, the one with the less electronegativity or larger size will be the central atom. Accordingly, I am going. So, 1, 2, 8 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 4 hydrogen has got their duplet. Nitrogen also has got its octet bearing a positive charge. NH4 plus, right? Next example, carbonate, CO3 power minus 2. So, as we have counted already, carbon contributes 4 valence electrons. 3 oxygens contribute to 3 into 6. Each oxygen has 6 valency electrons, 18 valency electrons, and 22 plus 2 additional electrons. Totally, using 24 valency electrons, we have to write the Lewis dot structure of a carbonate. Right? Let us see. Carbon is surrounded by 3 oxygens. Right? Carbon and oxygen both should get octet. 1, 2. 3, 4, 5, 6. So, between carbon and oxygen, 1 single covalent bond I assigned, of which carbon has not get its octet. Have you noticed? So, let us take with one oxygen multiple bond. Multiple bond means double and triple bonds are called as multiple bonds. Now, carbon's octet is satisfied. 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2, 8. Clear? Now, when it comes to oxygen, out of 24, 8 electrons we distributed. Rest 16 electrons are to be used. 16 means 1, 2, 3, 4. 4, 4 and 4. Now by distributing 4 plus 4 plus 4, 12 electrons we have distributed. So that this oxygen has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 8 electrons. This oxygen has got its 8 electrons. Carbon anyhow got 8 electrons. What about this left side oxygen? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Only it has got 6 electrons. So, give 2 more electrons. Total it has got 8. Give 2 more electrons. 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2, 8. So, totally bearing 2 units negative charge. In this way, we can write the Lewis dot structure for most of the molecules. But the problem with this method is no data is given about the structures of molecules and their properties. Okay, bond angles, bond energies, all these parameters were not explained by Lewis dot models. Now let's go to our next concept, that is Poisson's rules. Now let's come to our next concept, that is Poisson's rules. Okay, now these Poisson's rules helps us in predicting the nature of the bond. These Poisson's rules helps us in predicting nature of the bond. Nature of the bond means when a chemical bond is formed between two atoms or two or more atoms, whatever it is, we must be in a position to predict whether it is ionic or covalent. Okay, that prediction can be done here. See, once again, I am repeating the line. Poisson's rules helps us only in predicting the nature of the bond, not in predicting strength of the bond. I am repeating, they do not help in predicting strength of the bond. Strength can be predicted only from lattice energy. Strength of the bond can be predicted only from lattice energy, right? So this Poisson's rules helps us in predicting nature of the bond. It means whether a bond is more ionic or more covalent, like that. The rules are, first one is, with increase in size of cation, with increase in size of cation, or decrease in size of anion, with increase in size of cation or decrease in size of anion, ionic character increases. Which character increases? Ionic character increases. See, in other way, we can present the same line. Larger the cation or smaller the anion, or both. Even in the first line also, with increase in size of cation or decrease in size of anion, or both. Here also, or both are happening. Then in both the cases, ionic character is said to be more. See, in a diagrammatic manner, larger the cation or smaller the anion or both. Larger the cation or smaller the anion, both, then ionic character will be more. That bond is said to be more ionic in character. In three modes of presentation, we can study this nature of the bond, right? What is the first rule? What is the first Poisson's rules? With increase in size of cation or decrease in size of anion, ionic character increases. With increase in size of cation, with increase in size of cation, or decrease in size of anion, or both, ionic character increases. Similarly, larger the cation or smaller the anion, or both, ionic character increases. In that way also we can predict. Now, let us see one example with respect to this. Suppose lithium, you take a common cation, sodium fluoride, sodium chloride, sodium bromide, and sodium iodide. The question is, which is more ionic among these list of compounds? Which is more ionic? So, how do you predict more ionic in character? Larger the cation or smaller the anion or both? Cation is same. We cannot make any change. Cation is same. Small anion is the criteria now, according to this, for this particular example, as cation is not varying, anion should be smaller to be more ionic in character. We know that among halogens, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, this is how the size varies. So, as cation size is not varying, small anion means more ionic in character. So, smaller anion is sodium fluoride. So, fluoride. So, therefore, sodium fluoride is said to be more ionic in character. Likewise, another example, lithium fluoride or lithium chloride, lithium bromide, lithium, lithium chloride, sodium chloride, potassium chloride, rubidium chloride, and cesium chloride. Which is more ionic in character? That's the question. More ionic means, what's the condition? Either cation should be large or anion should be small, or both should happen. But here we cannot compare anion. Anion is same. So as anion size is the same, we can compare with the size of cation. So larger the cation, more is the ionic character. So which cation is larger among alkali metals? Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium. So this is how the size varies. No, So large cation, cesium chloride, this is said to be more ionic in character. In this way, one can predict the nature of the bond using this Poisson's rule. This is the first rule we have discussed. Once again, what is the first rule? With increase in size of cation or decrease in size of anion or both, ionic character increases, right? When it comes to the second rule, see, it is opposite to the first rule. Smaller the cation or larger the anion or both. Smaller the cation or larger the anion or both, then covalent character will be more. Okay, as per the line, we have to assign that covalent character will be more, right? Similarly, this can also be presented as with the decrease in size of cation, with the decrease in size of cation or increase in size of anion, increase in size of anion or both covalent character increases. According to this presentation, that we have to understand. Once again, smaller the cation or larger the anion or both, covalent character will be more. Covalent character will be more. Or with the decrease in size of cation or increase in size of anion or both, covalent character increases. Diagram method is smaller the cation or larger the anion or both, then covalent character will be more. So this is how the second rule, Poisson rule, can be considered. For example, again you take the same example, lithium chloride, lithium bromide and lithium iodide. Suppose, so which is more covalent? Which is more covalent out of this? More covalent means either cation should be smaller or anion should be larger or both. Here cation is same. Here cation is same. As cation is same, we have to decide with respect to size of anion, right? Wherever anion is larger, that is more covalent. So you know the size of halogens, fluorine, chlorine, bromine and iodine. So fluorine to iodine size increases. This is the larger anion. So this is more covalent in character. So whenever small cation and large anion is there, that bond is said to be more covalent in character. Understood? Similarly, one more example we can take. Now this time when we take a varying, so lithium fluoride, sodium fluoride, potassium fluoride, rubidium fluoride and cesium fluoride. Which is more covalent? Among them, which is relatively more covalent? That's the question. More covalent means either cation should be smaller or anion should be larger. Anion is quite same. Anion is same in all these cases. So small cation will be more covalent in character. So this is relatively more covalent. More covalent and less ionic. So large cation and small anion, this is more ionic according to the first rule, more ionic and less covalent, right? Of course, it is anyhow ionic, there is no covalent character. In case of lithium, there is some small covalent character because of the polarizing power of cation. Now we are going to discuss that polarizing power concept also. So far we discussed two lines under Poisson's rules. One is larger cation, smaller anion means more ionic. Smaller cation, larger anion means more covalent in character. Now let's come to the third Poisson rule, that is with increase in charge on cation and anion, with increase in charge on cation and anion, covalent character increases. With increase in charge on cation and anion, covalent character increases. Like suppose you take sodium fluoride, magnesium oxide, aluminium nitride. So why, how covalent character increases, why covalent character increases? Now we can analyze that. See, now among sodium, magnesium, aluminium, sodium, magnesium, aluminium, these three comes across a period. Sodium to magnesium to aluminium size decreases. And Na plus, Mg2 plus, Al plus 3, with increase in plus charge in isoelectronic species. As the plus charge increases, size decreases. We already studied it two times. Okay, so Al plus 3, sodium to magnesium to aluminium, sizes, cation size is decreasing. Okay, as the charge increases, size is decreasing. Next, F minus, O minus 2, N minus 3. These are the anions. See, anion charge is also increasing. With increasing charge and anion, they said. See, like nitrogen, nitride, oxide, fluoride. Even these three are also isoelectronic species only. With increase in negative charge, we studied with increase in negative charge, size increases. So, as the negative charge increases, size of anion is increasing. Size of cation is decreasing, size of anion is increasing. Smaller the cation and larger the anion, this is more covalent according to rule 2. Okay, the, relatively, this is more ionic. So, with increase in charge and cation, its size decreases. See, even though I had shown here in a reverse way, this is Na plus. Now this is Mg2 plus. Now this is Al plus 3. So with increase in plus charge on cation, size, its size decreases. With increase in charge on anion, its size increases. So as smaller the cation and larger the anion, more covalent character according to rule 2. Larger cation and smaller anion, more ionic according to rule 1. In this way, this point also explains, also strengthens the first and second points. Okay. Next, fourth one is, smaller the cation, more is its polarizing power. Similarly, larger the anion, more is its polarizability. Larger the anion, more is its polarizability. Copy these lines, because now we have to discuss with respect to some diagram. Smaller the cation, more is its polarizing power. Larger the anion, more is its polarizability. What are these polarizing power and polarizability? Let us discuss with small diagram. Okay, copy these lines. Now let us see. Suppose you are given with a cation and an anion. Cation and an anion. Between a cation and anion, what type of bond we expect? Obviously, between two oppositely charged ions, electrostatic force of attraction exists. That is ionic bond we expect. Expected ionic bond, right? But in the Fezzan's rule, it is given, whenever cation is smaller, anion is larger, the bond is more covalent. Let us see how it is becoming more covalent from expected ionic bond nature, right? See, this cation is smaller means its nucleus is more effective. Nucleus is more effective. Okay, means this nucleus can attract electrons strongly. When it comes to anion, as the distance is more between nucleus and electrons, electrons are weakly held to the nucleus. That's why, because of that reason, even these electrons also will be attracted by cations and nucleus. You follow the line. Electrons of anion also will get attracted by nucleus of cation. So because of that, what happens when cation's nucleus is attracting electrons of anion also, these electrons now, this is the nucleus of anion. Electrons are now said to be polarized. See, this anion is now said to be polarized. Electrons are now far from its own nucleus. This such an anion in which there is no uniform distribution of electron density. Here it is uniform. See, here electrons are uniformly distributing around the nucleus. But when they were attracted by the nucleus of small cation, there is no uniform distribution of electrons in this anion. Such an anion is said to be polarized anion. Such an anion is said to be what? Polarized anion. And because of this phenomena and this power of this smaller nucleus is called as polarizing power. Such a power of smaller nucleus to attract the electrons of anion and to polarize that anion is called as polarizing power. Smaller the size of cation, more is its polarizing power. Larger the size of anion, more is its polarizability. So in this way, the electrons will come across the internuclear axis. Electrons will be across the internuclear axis, which is a property of covalent bond. This electron density along the line joining the two nuclei takes place only in a covalent bond. Thus, the expected ionic bond is finally turned into a covalent bond because of polarizing power of smaller cation and polarizability of larger anion. In this way, Fasan's rules successfully explained the nature of bond, whether it is ionic or covalent, from ionic how it will be transformed to covalent bond, etc. Go through the rules once again and practice some questions from this worksheet I am going to send.